I'm just steps away from my first in-person rehearsal with the wind ensemble.
You know, last year was really tough getting started as a master's student here. Not a lot of time for socialization, trying to meet people over Zoom.
I was really impressed with what the University of Minnesota did with the smaller ensembles, but you know, having class over Zoom and having only 30-minute rehearsals made things tough.
So I know that we're all excited and looking forward to really getting back together and being able to make music again in a way that's fulfilling for everyone. Super excited. I've never played with the entire wind ensemble in person before, just the small chamber groups last year, so I'm really looking forward to playing with everybody and in Ted Mann as well. The acoustics are fantastic in here, so that's pretty exciting. And here we are.
Music together again is so meaningful. It makes my heart just full to see everybody's faces again, because there were some people that were online and I haven't seen in a year or more.
But you know, now you're sitting on stage, 90 people, and you got your section around you, and you know, various people in front of them, behind you. So there's the shared energy of these people on stage, and there's kind of this buzz of rehearsal that's constantly in the air. There's pages flipping and people writing.
It's good to have that sense of community in person again and to be part of.
Music has the ability to bring us to a different place and to unify.
It's another way of communication that also transcends language and connects people of all different backgrounds and ways of life in a way that nothing else really can.
Welcome to the CLA Celebration Concert, featuring performances from Gospel Choir, World Music Ensemble, Symphonic Band, University Singers, Opera Theater, Trumpet Studio, Wind Ensemble, Jazz Ensemble, University Symphony Orchestra, students and faculty from the Department of Theater Arts and Dance, and the Minnesota Marching Band. All this and more on the CLA Celebration Concert. Here's your host, Tony Award-winning CLA alum, Santino Fontana.
Hello. And welcome, everyone. I am honored to be a part of this unique celebration of the liberal arts and can't wait for you to see what's in store. As a graduate of CLA's Guthrie Theater BFA Actor Training Program, I'm obviously a big believer in the arts. It's through the liberal arts that we learn to ask questions about the world around us and cultivate our skills as storytellers, whether that story is told through a song, dance, painting, poem, or monologue. As an actor, it's magical to bring a group of strangers together and then shine a light on the joys and pains of being human through the imagined narrative of a show. Through that shared experience, we all walk away feeling connected in a way that helps us feel less alone. That's why we do what we do. As we know, especially from the last 2 years, life is hard. And we should cherish any opportunity to be reminded that we're not alone in our fears, joys, sorrows, or celebrations. My time at the U of M was incredibly influential to who I am today. I learned that the best actors are smart and educated and curious and also able to navigate a very complicated world. I discovered that the learning process never ends because every acting project requires a completely different set of skills. I learned that it's not a question of what you can and can't do. It's a question of what do you already know versus what do you need to still learn. Our professors taught us to always remain inquisitive and curious and to be willing to put the time and effort into learning something new. The skills and worldview that were cultivated in me during my time in the program have stayed with me. And I'm grateful for an institution that gave me a safe place to learn about the world, my passion, and myself. Today, you'll see and hear some inspiring examples of creative ways our students, faculty, and staff are keeping the arts alive in these times of uncertainty. This concert is our gift to you to say thank you for supporting the liberal arts at the University of Minnesota. Without you, none of this would be possible. First up are performances from the U of M's Gospel Choir and the World Music Ensemble Band. Please enjoy.
Yeah. It's the University of Minnesota Gospel Choir. Glory, hallelujah. Let's go, Dan.
Thank you.
I'm Josephine Lee. I'm the Associate Dean for Arts and Humanities in the College of Liberal Arts. Watching and hearing such creative work by a younger generation feels nothing short of miraculous these days. Now more than ever, we need the arts and humanities to help us understand the complexity of our experiences, our relationships, and our feelings. In a world that often feels divisive, art can bring us together and present possibilities for doing, seeing, and hearing things just a little bit differently. Art asks us to pause, to reflect, to listen and observe one another deeply, and to move outside of the boundaries and repeating habits and ways of thinking that often dictate our everyday lives. The performance you're about to watch was choreographed and directed by CLA Dean's medalist, Carl Flink, and performed by his dance company, Black Label Movement. This piece, A Dream of Touch When Touch Is Gone, was created during the pandemic with guidance from Dr. John Halberg from the U of M Medical School. He developed a COVID bubble that allowed Black Label Movement to responsibly remove their masks and come into physical contact during the shooting of the film. This performance shows us how new conditions of making art, however difficult and restrictive, can inspire even greater creativity. Here, dance, music, and video recording come together to take us on a sometimes somber, sometimes painful, yet beautiful journey. This work speaks directly to the moment we're living in and lets us come together as an audience to explore both the concerns and problems that worry us, the grief that we need to express, and the mundane moments of wonder and joy that we might otherwise miss. Please enjoy.
the llama sees the penguin. The penguin's kind of standing in the middle of the tracks, but the penguin doesn't realize that the train's coming. The llama sees the train, it starts running down a hill, rolls into the penguin, and then rolls off the tracks in a really like triumphant way. So the castanets here are kind of to drive the entire scene and build intensity.
My name's Arush Bothra. I'm a percussion performance major. I'm currently a sophomore, but I composed this piece as a freshman. Over the summer, I was trying to kind of get into film scoring a little bit. I tried a couple things here and there, tried a couple little projects. But one thing I finally landed on was a competition for an open source film called Caminantes y Amigos. I entered that competition. Originally, I only scored this for a couple instruments, a percussion, piano, and a glockenspiel. I didn't really hear back from the competition, but I got really lucky in that percussion professor saw it because we communicate through Facebook for like percussion studio stuff. So he saw it on my Facebook page, and he showed Professor Lucard. He showed a bunch of other professors. He shared it with a bunch of people. And that's how Professor Lucard saw it.
It was like a hallway conversation. And I said, well, have you ever thought about scoring it for wind players or percussionists? I know you're a percussionist. Would you have any interest in that? So we exchanged ideas about that. And I said, you know, it would be perfect. We can have 19 people. That's what we can physically distance on Ted Mann stage and rehearse. So the size ended up being the orchestration. Of course, he wrote for the absolute maximum, you know, being a Roosh.
This is good. Isn't this fun? Keep saying that. I just love this project. Arush. Man.
What? And it was fun for the students because it was one of their own. And it's like one student can do that. It gives permission for other students to try, which is really the educational piece of all of this, not just the performance piece, but the educational piece is it rubs off. Others want to do what he's done. Not for the recognition, but for the art, for the creativity, and the idea, and the possibility. So it was an exciting project.
Thank you. As you've seen throughout the program, tonight is all about celebrating our liberal arts community and reflecting on all that we've been through over the past several years. When I arrived on campus in 2014, I said that I wanted CLA to be on offense, not defense, that I wanted to promote and elevate all the ways a liberal arts education creates opportunities for students and helps envision and create more equitable and vibrant communities. Through gifts to CLA's Shattering Expectations campaign, alumni and friends of the college have invested $182 million to transform CLA into a destination college, a place where all of us are proud to do our best work. These gifts have made internship opportunities possible for students to gain valuable skills and experiences that help them excel after graduation. They've allowed students to go abroad, to learn about new cultures and explore new ways of understanding the world. They've seeded new research and creative work and helped recruit talented faculty, giving them resources to pursue new lines of thinking and solutions to some of the most pressing issues we face, like criminal justice reform, political polarization, economic opportunity, and building a more just and equitable world. They've helped create new facilities like Pillsbury Hall, home to the Department of English, in our new Liberal Arts Engagement Hub. They've bridged campus and community, helping us develop greater awareness and knowledge of the issues we face and to work together to imagine new futures. Through all of these investments, you've provided resources to help CLA meet the moment and prepare for the future. Thank you. The future we envision is one where everyone has equal access to higher education, where every member of our community feels a sense of belonging. I've said before that CLA is the opportunity college, a place where the lives of individuals, families, and communities are transformed. This isn't just about being the best in the world, it's about being our best for the world. Because the better we are at our work, the better our research, the more ready our graduates, the greater good we can do for Minnesota and for the world. Thank you for making that work possible. And thank you for all you have done to make Shattering Expectations a resounding success. Next up is CLA's latest installment of our Research and Creative Excellence series. The stories you're about to hear highlight the ways CLA faculty across the college use their research and creative work to investigate and exemplify our values of justice, dignity, and respect.
How we are linked to the work we do is deeply personal. I was born and raised in St. Paul, and I spent the majority of my life growing up in Minnesota, being one of the only students of color in my classes, the only Chicana for sure. In my teaching, in my scholarship, and through my creative work, I investigate how Chicanas, Latinx subvert systemic inequalities by creating alternative narratives and spaces. Thinking about networks and relationships as constellations, myself and the other artists of color I collaborate with are trying to create work that fosters a sense of belonging and deep connection that extends beyond the production of the art itself. Work that ignites the imaginations of our community and inspires an alternative to the isolation many of us have felt. My goal is to tell stories and work with others to tell their stories so that another little girl who is growing up now doesn't have to feel like she's the only one in her class.
Everyone comes from somewhere, and where we come from shapes how we live our lives. For the past 20 years at the U, I've been studying the lives of Korean youth adopted internationally by white families. I'm interested in how adoptees navigate the paradox of growing up as a minority in their own family with minimal connection to their Korean heritage. Though I'm not adopted, how people make sense of their ethnicity and race resonate with my immigrant family upbringing. My parents immigrated from South Korea in the mid-1960s and owned family cleaners and tailors while I was growing up in Connecticut. I pay tribute to my parents' dreams and sacrifices by referring to my research team as the Family Lab. My 87-year-old dad now lives with my family. He's an artist, and in his backyard studio paints Korean landscapes from memory. My new work is trying to capture how homeland yearnings persist among immigrants, even 50 years later.
As a mortality demographer, I study heavy questions, literal matters of life and death. But the most difficult part of my work is figuring out precisely what question to pursue. When I'm in the grip of one of these intellectual puzzles, the way I make progress is by coming back to the data over and over again, relentlessly, until something finally clicks and I understand it by seeing it in a new way. The question I asked myself in my most recent study is how the catastrophic scale of death due to the COVID-19 pandemic compares to another US catastrophe, racial inequality. I discovered that even if Black Americans had been immune to the coronavirus, their mortality this year would probably still be higher than white mortality during the pandemic. Once we see that racial inequality means a pandemic's worth of death to Black Americans every single year, it should change the way we think about fighting racism. When we consider ideas like reparations or defunding the police, our question should shift from what's politically palatable to just what will work.
What does it take to make a way through a situation that looks impossible? As a writer and educator, I want to help explore what it means to reckon with instability and discomfort, to work with the mess and read the big patterns that stay happening, despite the differences playing over the surface. I'm also concerned with interdisciplinary modes of composition in music and text, the social and private. How is composition embodied and enacted in the work I'm making? Especially when so much of my work critiques the nexus of spectacle, violence, and power. In all of my compositions, poetry, libretti, essays, visual texts, I'm trying to hold contradiction without seeking to resolve it. How do we live in that indeterminate space?
The work I create reflects a diverse and interconnected visual history. My research begins with quilts made by enslaved and free African American women during the time of enslavement through the 20th century. My art is informed by the realities of those who stitched and sewed a resolute legacy that has gifted freedom, personhood, and rich visual language to our world. I love working with clay. Clay is egalitarian, but at the same time indifferent. It doesn't matter how skilled you are. You have to work with and respond to it. When I begin making tiles, I have no idea what the resulting quilt will look like. What I'm really doing is exploring the substance of the clay itself, challenging the intrinsic properties of the material. I strive to sustain and honor the many gifts of my personal and collective history embedded in the visual chronicles of my communal ancestry.
There's so much more socially constructed meaning in the way we speak than people realize. Do you expect someone to sound different depending on whether you're listening to a man or a woman? Whether you've decided that the person is gay or straight?
We all have preconceptions about how people's voices will match their faces. And previous studies suggest people are better at recognizing faces within their own ethnic group. We're asking the question of how much that same principle extends into speech perception.
Since all of the existing research in the field of speech-language hearing sciences is based solely on white varieties, we realized that to study this question, we had to create a new database pulling from a more diverse population sample.
Creating this resource for anyone to use is an important contribution to increasing representation in research and a step towards addressing historical inequity in the discipline of speech-language hearing sciences as a whole. If we want our science to reflect reality, then we need our research data to reflect it as well.
When I was applying for college, way back when, let's not talk about my age, I learned about this new program in Minneapolis that was getting ready to induct its very first class, and I was encouraged to apply. The founder of the program, Ken Washington, wanted to create a program that trained a young actor's mind with a liberal arts curriculum alongside a rigorous conservatory-style training to prepare them to tackle the classics of the past, present, and future. That program became the U of M's Guthrie Theater BFA Actor Training Program, and I became part of its very first class. We were taught by our lead acting instructor, Scott Freeman, that the best actors are part scholar, part athlete, and part poet. Those first 4 years of the program were frightening, thrilling, and unpredictable. They called us trailblazers, but we called ourselves guinea pigs. And alongside me in that first class of BFA scholars was my now dear friend, Aya Cash, who has gone on to have a very successful career acting in both television and film and on stage. She is here with us to share about her own experience in the program. So I'll turn it over to you, Aya.
Thank you, Santino. My story is actually very similar to yours in that I was looking for something that gave me a full education on top of intensive acting training. And most conservatories don't really offer that. It's not that I wanted to study other things as a fallback to acting. I had no fallback. But I did want a sort of full comprehensive education as an additive to my acting training. And I found the University of Minnesota offered both. It was also really exciting to be a part of the first class. We were made to feel like we were going to be able to shape and contribute to what this new thing was. Whether or not that's true, who knows? But we were excited to be a part of that process. It was painful. It was exhilarating. It was all the things that an actual career in the arts is. I think we've learned now just how important the arts are, because the person who tells the best story shapes the world. And we are the storytellers who give shape to reality. I think the University of Minnesota at the Guthrie really helped give us those tools. And so now, up next is a video that brings us behind the scenes of the Department of Theater Arts and Dance and gives us a glimpse of just how many hands are involved in bringing a light to production.
this world. I can't sleep at the edge of the window at night. Moonlight beams at the edge of the window, my guide.
My name is Amber Frederick. I'm currently working on She Kills Monsters, which is a main stage for the 2021 fall season. This year has been so much fun to get back into various workplaces, not just the stage, which itself has been such a joy, but the scene shop, the costume shop, to get back into the room with all of those people.
That's adorable. I think
the creativity and the spark that each of them brings, and to be back after such a long time feels so good.
I am making a piece about how COVID really affected my relationship with my brother, who has autism. I couldn't see him for about a year and a half. We had to get together on the holidays without him. My grandpa ended up passing during this time, and we attended the funeral together, but Jack couldn't be there. So it was just like a really hard time.
That's kind of him.
This piece just really encompasses like our relationship growing up together and Jack being all alone, and then us coming together.
We're gonna go into that little flippy turn thing.
Yeah! I'm working on Junk.
What do you think?
It's part of the BFA showcase series, and I'm doing the lighting design for it. I've had a great working relationship with my partner, Bella, and we kind of collaborate on all the different looks that we're doing. I'm really, really glad to be back in the Kilburn, and it's been really awesome to do lighting design in person again.
We have a space where we can come together, fill it up with life and energy and creativity that's been there for us through COVID until now. And it's stayed there and it's been steadfast and continuously a place where we can come together and really experience the magic of theater.
It is really incredible just how many people, how many sets of skills it takes to bring a performance to an audience. as we just saw, from lighting to costume design to set design, it really does take a village. I see this all the time in my own career. It is so nice to see the theater arts and dance department thriving. It brings me back to so many times in those rehearsal spaces. I am so happy to be a part of this celebration for my alma mater. Enjoy the rest of the concert.
And now, from the Ted Mann Concert Hall, located on the West Bank of the University of Minnesota Twin Cities campus, the 2021 Virtual Collage Concert.
I hope you've enjoyed this concert celebration as much as I have. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for your support of the College of Liberal Arts. Experiences like this highlight the role of the arts in bringing us all together, and I, for one, can't wait until we can do this all again in person. Ah, we're so close, right? We have to be. There's no better way to wrap up this concert than with the University of Minnesota's marching band, so please enjoy this performance of the Minnesota Rouser, and thank you again for watching.